Dr. Craig, thank you for returning my call. I appreciate that.
Yeah, I'm sorry for the delay. I'm calling from Jerusalem. I have to give a lecture any minute. I didn't want to keep you waiting.
I'll cut right to the chase.
So I've been doing research into the purported resurrection of Jesus, and I want to run a theory by you. Maybe the reason
that the tomb was empty was because Jesus' body was never there in the first place.
Because we know that the Romans used to throw the bodies of crucifixion subjects to the dogs, right?
Well, there's no evidence for that, but there are specific records that didn't happen to Jesus.
And what records are those?
Well, actually, the earliest recorded accounts tell us that Jesus was properly buried in a tomb. And the Romans did allow for burial of some crucifixion victims.
But then there's something that still doesn't add up
to me about all of these supposed eyewitnesses
that claim to have found Jesus' empty tomb.
What, the fact that they were all women?
Yeah, because we know that, according to Jewish customs, women were deemed to be unreliable witnesses. Am I right?
Well, true. So why did all four gospel writers record that it was women who discovered the empty tomb?
I'm asking you that.
Well, if you were a first century Jew making up this story out of thin air, then you would never say that women discovered the tomb. It would damage your case, not help it.
Okay, so maybe we're dealing with the world's most inept disciples.
Or maybe the disciples reported what actually happened and let the chips fall where they may.
Okay, all right, but you have to admit here that there is a gaping hole in all of this.
A gaping hole. Well,
the fact that the Gospels are filled with contradictions about the empty tomb, okay? If I turned in a story that was this jumbled, I'd be out of a job. If we look through the Gospels, you started Matthew, okay? Matthew puts Mary Magdalene and some other Mary at the tomb. You flip over to Mark, he adds Salome. You go to Luke, he adds
Mary, mother of James, and some lady named Joanna.
What is that? You need a Sherpa guide to sort your way through this mess.
Sure, there are differences, but that doesn't trouble most historians.
Why? Why doesn't that trouble? It troubles me. It should trouble them.
Because the core of the story is the same in all four. After Jesus is placed in the tomb, it's visited on Sunday morning by a small group of women, and they find the body is gone.
Now, you've studied law.
Yale law, yes.
And then you know that when policemen question several witnesses at a crime scene, they never expect the secondary details to be consistent as long as the core account is the same. In fact, if they're too similar, it's suspect.
That's true.
Well, that's exactly what we're talking about here.
The empty tomb is based on evidence, and isn't evidence your trade?
It is. Yes, but what if
the resurrection is one of the historical details that was recorded incorrectly?
How can we know? How can we ever know?
Lee, let me ask you something. Do you really want to know the truth, or is your mind already made up, regardless of the facts?
Oh, look, Doc.
I'm a journalist, okay? It's my job to challenge assumptions until they're proven otherwise. That's all I'm doing.
No, I get that. But when is enough evidence enough evidence?
He's so frustrating. I'm just not good at this, I guess. I want to share it with him. I want to celebrate it, and I'm walking on eggshells in my own home.
Well, it's probably the same for him. He's walking on eggshells.
Hey, just because they said they saw Jesus doesn't mean they actually did.
I'm sorry, was that for me?
Maybe the eyewitnesses of the resurrection, maybe they're delusional. You know what I mean? Maybe they only thought they saw Jesus, or maybe it was like mind control. Or brainwashing. Rod!
You need to see a psychologist.
Oh, you think I got a screw loose?
Yeah, well, that's another story. But if you're talking about first century mass psychosis, you need to talk to a psychologist.
I'm already ahead of you. Rod! Hey, I need you to find me a good psychologist to interview.
A psychologist,
that's right. A guy with a lot of academic street cred, knows the human mind better than God does.
No pressure, kid.
Don't listen to him.
Dr. Roberta Waters, president of the American Association of Psychoanalysts, agnostic.
Ah, agnostic, final.
And a leading authority on human behavior at Purdue University.
Indiana, great. Dr. Waters.
Ah, hello, Mrs. Strobel. As much as I would like to help a fellow skeptic, what you're proposing is completely impossible.
But how can you say that? I mean, if Charles Manson can turn his followers into murderous zombies, surely the followers of the Christ cult could be convinced of their own delusions?
Listen, hallucinations are like dreams. They happen in individual minds. They don't spread like the common cold.
Okay, so a hypnotist turns a stage full of insurance salesmen into clucking chickens. Then that's not really happening, or?
No, of course it is. The power of suggestion can be very profound, but it's one thing to be mesmerized into making animal noises. It's quite another for 500 people to have the same dream. To be honest, that would be an even bigger miracle than the resurrection itself.
And without an empty tomb, you and I, we're not even having this conversation. If Jesus recovered from his injuries, that solves that problem. All these people could have easily seen him, yes?
Yes, but I'm afraid that's not a brain issue. You need to speak to a medical doctor.
Of course. Dr. Waters, again, thank you for your time. You've been most gracious.
Forgive me for making you travel all the way out here, but when someone rings me up and says he wants to dispute the most significant event in human history, I feel it's important that we do it face to face, don't you?
Yeah, that's fine. I appreciate your time. So, my line of attack is this. The reason the eyewitnesses were able to see Jesus after Golgotha is because he never died on the cross.
Because if he doesn't die, there's no resurrection, yes?
That's right. So whether or not Jesus himself or someone else took him off of the cross early, or if he fakes his own death, it doesn't matter. It completely discounts every aspect of the resurrection.
Right, the swoon theory.
Yeah, but he passed out. He didn't die.
I'm afraid there's a long line of skeptics in front of you with that hypothesis.
Including only a billion Muslims the world over who also don't believe that Jesus died on the cross because the Quran says so.
With all due respect to Islam, the Quran was written 6 centuries after Christ. I prefer my historical sources a bit closer to accuracy.
I understand, but you concede that it's possible.
Mr. Strobel, I am a medical doctor and scientist. I have seen a great many strange phenomena in my lifetime. Mm-hmm. But the swoon theory is rubbish.
Rubbish. Is that a medical opinion?
It is, actually. Swoon theorists tend to skim over the fact that Jesus was flogged prior to his crucifixion. Do you know what happens in a Roman flogging?
The person is lashed with a whip.
No, not lashed. Scourged and pummeled savagely. You see, the cowhide whip is braided with metal balls and bone fragments. The flesh on Jesus' back would have been shredded. The very muscles and sinews themselves laid open to exposure. The flogging itself would have left Jesus in critical condition from massive blood loss, which is why he collapsed under the weight of the cross that the Romans made him carry through town.
Okay, so is it possible that Jesus survives being spiked to the cross?
Oh, yes, you could survive it, but it's child's play compared to what comes next in a crucifixion. Slow, agonizing death by asphyxiation. Come with me. The stress on Jesus' chest muscles would have locked his lungs into the inhale position. Right? So in order to let the breath out, he would have had to shove himself up using his spiked wrists and feet, scraping his shredded back against the wood of the cross, and then sagged back down again in order to draw his next breath, which he would have to have done over and over and over again, until utter exhaustion just made it impossible. And then inevitably,
he dies, in theory. But let's remember, these soldiers, they're not doctors, okay? So maybe they took him off the cross and they thought he was dead, but in fact he wasn't.
No, of course they weren't medical doctors, they were professional killers. Right? And they were quite good at their jobs. They had to be. If a prisoner escaped alive, they themselves would be executed. Mr. Strobel, the crucifixion of Jesus is one of the best attested events in the ancient world. And, if you will, the final nail in the coffin, at least from the theory, is this. When the soldiers thrust their spear between Jesus' ribs, do you know what came out? Blood and water, which we now know is a description of pericardial effusion as a result of death by asphyxiation. This is not a condition anyone could fake. And so to answer your question, yes, it is my medical opinion that Jesus Christ died on that cross.
Excuse me, doctor.
A moment.
But I have a real problem with most of the experts that I've talked to here.
Which is?
Which is that most of them are not impartial, and if I'm going to take a guess, I would say that you are not either.
And you would be correct, sir. Though I have learned that most impartial travelers who undertake this journey rarely remain so. However, I can refer you to one of the most impartial sources that I know. You trust the Journal of the American Medical Association?
Of course, it is a stellar scientific journal, you and I will admit that. On the physical death of Jesus, clearly the weight of the medical and historical evidence indicates that Jesus was dead before the wound to his side was inflicted. Accordingly, interpretations based on the assumption that Jesus did not die on the cross appear to be at odds with modern medical knowledge. Doc, I gotta tell you, you're not telling me what I hope to hear today.
Followed every lead.
At some point, young man, you're going to have to plant your flag on a mountain of uncertainty where not every question is answered. The human mind will never get to the bottom of every mystery in the cosmos. Believing in God, not believing in God, either way, still takes a leap of faith.
So you're saying, even in our disbelief, that we still take a leap of faith?
More or less. Me? Well, I've come to my own conclusion. You're gonna have to do the same thing for yourself.
One of my heroes was C.S. Lewis, a man who began as a skeptic, much like yourself. At the end of his journey, you know what he said? He said, if Christianity is false, it's of zero importance. But if it's true, there's nothing more important in the entire universe.
Please soften Lee's heart. Put a new spirit in him. Remove from him his heart of stone and give him a heart of flesh.
The only way to truth is through facts.
The entire Christian faith hinges on the resurrection of Jesus. If it didn't happen, it's a house of cards.
You just have to show that Jesus died and was seen afterwards.
How can we be sure of the reliability of those manuscripts?
Archaeologists have recovered 5,843 Greek New Testament manuscripts. Nothing else in history even comes close.
Trust the Journal of the American Medical Association.
Yes, Jesus Christ died on that cross.
You're not telling me what I hope to hear today.
It is true. You want to know that?
The first recorded account tells us that he was buried in a tomb. The empty tomb is based on evidence. Isn't evidence your trade?
Faith is the evidence of things we can't actually see.
Any careful historian will see that the core account is consistent, even if a few of the secondary details are told from different perspectives.
500 separate people saw Jesus at the same time.
That would be an even bigger miracle than the resurrection itself.
The disciples reported what actually
happened. People with zero motivation to lie.
When is enough absence enough?
I felt something that is maybe more real than anything I've ever felt in my life.
This is not the condition.
Still takes a leap of faith.
But why would he do it?
It's really very simple. Love.
When you became a Christian, I freaked out. I mean, yeah, I was scared. And I felt like that I needed to save you. And so I decided to set out to prove this was all a big con. And so that's what I've been doing all this time.
Your research?
Yeah, look at this. This is all that stuff. That's why I've been so distracted. That's why I went to California. I just had to prove this whole thing wrong. But I couldn't. The evidence for your faith, it's more overwhelming than I could have ever imagined.
But it wasn't just the evidence, okay? It was you. You never stopped loving me. You never gave up on me. And I think because of that, God didn't either.
Oh. What? I mean, I don't think God gave up on you either, but what are you saying?
I can't even fathom that I'm gonna say these words out loud. I believe.